Gabriel Conroy. By Bret Harte. Podcast 10 of 16. Book 5. The Vein. Chapter 4. M.R. Dumphy has news of a domestic character. An earthquake, echoed Mr. Rolling Stone, cheerfully, to his guests, now you've had about everything we have to show. Don't be alarmed, madam, he continued to Mrs. Rayner, who was beginning to show symptoms of hysteria, nobody ever was hurt by M. In 200 years there hasn't been as many persons killed by earthquakes in California as are struck by lightning on your coast in a single summer, said Mr. Dumphy. Never have M any stronger than this, said Mr. Pilcher, with a comforting suggestion on there being an absolute limitation of nature's freaks on the Pacific coast. Over in a minute, as you see, said Mr. Dumphy, and hello, what's that? In a moment they were on their feet, pale and breathless again. This time Mr. Rayner and his wife among the number. But it was only a carriage driving away. Let us adjourn to the piazza, said Mr. Dumphy, offering his arm to Mrs. Rayner with the air of having risen solely for that purpose. Mr. Dumphy led the way, and the party followed with some seal writing. Mrs. Sepulveda hung back a moment with Arthur, and whispered. Take me back as soon as you can. You are not seriously alarmed, asked Arthur. We are too near the sea here, she replied, looking toward the ocean with a slight shudder. Don't ask questions now, she added, a little sharply. Don't you see these eastern people are frightened to death, and they may overhear. But Mrs. Sepulveda had not long to wait, for in spite of the pointed asseverations of Messrs. Pilcher, Dice, and Dumphy, that earthquakes were not only harmless, but absolutely possessed a sanitary quality, the piazzas were found deserted by the usual pleasure seekers, and even the eloquent advocates themselves betrayed some impatience to be once more on the open road. A brisk drive of an hour put the party again in the highest spirits, and Mr. and Mrs. Rayner again into the condition of chronic admiration and enthusiasm. Mrs. Sepulveda and Mr. Poinsett followed in an open buggy behind. When they were fairly upon their way, Arthur asked an explanation of his fair companion's fear of the sea. There is an old story, said Donna Maria, that the Point of Pines, you know where it is, Mr. Poinsett was once covered by a great wave from the sea that followed an earthquake. But tell me, do you really think that letter of this man Conroy is true? I do, said Arthur, promptly. And that there is a prospect that the stock of this big mine may depreciate in value. Well, possibly yes. And if you knew that I had been foolish enough to put a good deal of money in it, you would still talk to me as you did the other day down there. I should say, responded Arthur, changing the reins to his left hand that his right might be free for some purpose goodness knows what, I should say that I am more than ever convinced that you ought to have some person to look after you. What followed this remarkable speech I really do not know how to reconcile with the statement that Mrs. Sepulveda made to the Donna Dolores a few chapters ago, and I therefore discreetly refrain from transcribing it here. Suffice it to say that the buggy did not come up with the Charay Bank and the rest of the party until long after they had arrived at Mr. Dumphy's stately mansion on Rincon Hill, where another costly and elaborate collation was prepared. Mr. Dumphy evidently was in spirits, and had so far overcome his usual awe and distrust of Arthur, as well as the slight jealousy he had experienced an hour or so before, as to approach that gentleman with a degree of cheerful familiarity that astonished and amused the self-sustained Arthur, who perhaps at that time had more reason for his usual conceit than before. Arthur, who knew, or thought he knew, that Miss Ringround was only coquetting with Mr. Dumphy for the laudable purpose of making the more ambitious of her sex miserable, and that she did not care for his person or position, was a good deal amused at finding the young lady the subject of Mr. Dumphy's sudden confidences. You see, Poinsett, as a man of business I don't go as much into society as you do, but she seems to be a straight up and down girl, eh? He queried, as they stood together in the vestibule after the ladies had departed. It is hardly necessary to say that Arthur was positive and sincere in his praise of the young woman. Mr. Dumphy, by some obscure mental process, taking much of the praise to himself, was highly elated and perhaps tempted to a greater vinous indulgence than was his habit. Howbeit the last bottle of champagne seemed to have obliterated all past suspicion of Arthur, and he shook him warmly by the hand. "I tell ye what now," Poinsett, "if there are any points I can give you, don't you be afraid to ask for em. I can see what's up between you and the widow Honor, you know all right, my boy, she's in the Conroy load pretty deep, but I'll help her out and you too. You've got a good thing there, Poinsett, and I want you to realize. We understand each other, eh? You'll find me a square man with my friends, Poinsett. Pitch in, my advice to you is to just pitch in and marry the widow. She's worth it, you can realize on her. You see, you and me, so to speak, old pards, eh? You recollect old times on Sweetwater, eh? Well, if you muse go, goodbye. I suppose she's waiting for yet. Look you, Poinsy, do ye see this your posy in my buttonhole? She give it to me. Rosie did. Eh? Ha? Ha? Won't tack nothing drink? Lesh open en or bowl? No. Gurry, until struggling between disgust, amusement, and self-depreciation, Arthur absolutely tore himself away from the great financier and his degrading confidences. When Mr. Dumphy staggered back into his drawing room, a servant met him with a card. "The gentleman says it's very important business, and he must see you tonight," he said, hastily, anticipating the oath and indignant protest of his master. "He says it's your business, sir, and not his. He's been waiting here since you came back, sir." Mr. Dumphy took the card. It bore the inscription in pencil, "Colonel Starbottle, Siskiyou, on important business." Mr. Dumphy reflected a moment. The magical word business brought him to himself. "Show him in the office," he said savagely, and retired thither. Anybody less practical than Peter Dumphy would have dignified the large, showy room in which he entered as the library. The rich mahogany shelves were filled with a heterogeneous collection of recent books, very fresh, very new and glaring as to binding and subject. The walls were hung with files of newspapers and stock reports. There was a velvet-lined cabinet containing minerals, all of them gold or silver bearing. There was a map of an island that Mr. Dumphy owned. There was a marine view, with a representation of a steamship also owned by Mr. Dumphy. There was a momentary relief from these facts in a very gorgeous and badly painted picture of a tropical forest and sea beach, until inquiry revealed the circumstance that the sugar house in the corner under a palm tree was run by Mr. Dumphy, and that the whole thing could be had for a bargain. The stranger who entered was large and somewhat inclined to a corpulency that was, however, restrained in expansion by a blue frock coat, tightly buttoned at the waist, which had the apparent effect of lifting his stomach into the higher thoracic regions of moral emotion, a confusion to which its owner lent a certain intellectual assistance. The colonel's collar was very large, open, and impressive, his black silk neckerchief loosely tied around his throat, occupying considerable space over his shirt front, and expanding through the upper part of a gilt-buttoned white waistcoat, lent itself to the general suggestion that the colonel had burst his sepals and would flower soon. Above this unfolding the colonel's face, purple, aquiline-nosed, throttle-looking as to the eye, and moist and sloppy-looking as to the mouth, up-tilted above his shoulders. The colonel entered with that tiptoeing seal-righty of step affected by men who are conscious of increasing corpulency. He carried a cane hooked over his forearm, in one hand a large white handkerchief, and in the other a broad-brimmed hat. He thrust the former gracefully in his breast, laid the latter on the desk where Mr. Dumphy was seated, and taking an unoffered chair himself, coolly rested his elbow on his cane in an attitude of easy expectancy. "Say, you've got important business," said Dumphy. "Hope it is, sir, hope it is. Then out with it. Can't afford to waste time any more here than at the bank. Come. What is it?" Not in the least affected by Mr. Dumphy's manner, whose habitual brusqueness was intensified to rudeness, Colonel Starbottle drew out his handkerchief, blew his nose, carefully returned apparently only about 2 inches of the cambric to his breast, leaving the rest displayed like a ruffled shirt, and began with an airy gesture of his fat white hand. I was here 2 hours ago, sir, when you were at the ER festive board. I said to the boy, don't interrupt your master. A gentleman worshipping at the shrine of Venus and Bacchus and attended by the muses and immortals, don't want to be interrupted. Ged, sir, I knew a man in Louisiana. Hank Pinckney shot his boy, a little yellow boy worth $1,000, for interrupting him at a poker party and no ladies present. And the boy only coming in to say that the gin house was in flames. Perhaps you'll say an extreme case. No, it doesn't such. So I said, don't interrupt him, but when the ladies have risen, and beauty, sir, no longer dazzles and ER gleams, and the table round no longer echoes the ER light jest, then spot him. And over the deserted board, with ER social glass between us, your master and I will have our little confab. He rose, and before the astonished Dumphy could interfere, crossed over to a table where a decanter of whiskey and a carafe of water stood, and filling a glass half full of liquor, resated himself and turned it off with an easy yet dignified inclination towards his host. For once only Mr. Dumphy regretted the absence of dignity in his own manner. It was quite evident that his usual brusqueness was utterly ineffective here, and he quickly recognized in the colonel the representative of a class of men well known in California, from whom any positive rudeness would have provoked a demand for satisfaction. It was not a class of men that Mr. Dumphy had been in the habit of dealing with, and he sat filled with impotent rage, but wise enough to restrain its verbal expression, and thankful that none of his late guests were present to witness his discomfiture. Only one good effect was due to his visitor. Mr. Dumphy, through baffled indignation and shame, had become sober. No, sir, continued Colonel Starbottle, setting his glass upon his knee, and audibly smacking his large lips. No, sir, I waited in the ER antechamber until I saw you part with your guests, until you bade ER adieu to a certain fair nymph. Ged, sir, I like your taste, and I call myself a judge of fine women. Blank it all, I said to myself, blank it all, Star, you ain't going to pop out upon a man just as he's ministering to beauty and putting a shawl upon a pair of alabaster shoulders like that. Ha! Ha! Ged, sir, I remembered myself that in 43 in Washington at a party at Tom Benton's I was in just such a position, sir. Are you never going to get that cloak on, Star? She says to me, the most beautiful creature, the acknowledged belle of that whole winter 43, sir. As a gentleman yourself you'll understand why I don't particularize. If I had my way, madam, I said, I never would. I did, blank me. But you're not drinking, Mr. Dumphy, eh? A thimbleful, sir, to our better acquaintance. Not daring to trust himself to speak, Mr. Dumphy shook his head somewhat impatiently, and Colonel Starbottle rose. As he did so, it seemed as if his shoulders had suddenly become broader and his chest distended until his handkerchief and white waistcoat protruded through the breast of his buttoned coat like a bursting grain of popcorn. He advanced slowly and with deliberate dignity to the side of Dumphy. If I have intruded upon your privacy, Mr. Dumphy, he said, with a stately wave of his white hand, if, as I surmise, from your disinclination, sir, to call it by no other name, to exchange the ordinary convivial courtesies common between gentlemen, sir, you are disposed to resent any reminiscences of mine as reflecting upon the character of the young lady, sir, whom I had the pleasure to see in your company. If such be the case, sir, Ged, I am ready to retire now, sir, and to give you tomorrow, or at any time, the satisfaction which no gentleman ever refuses another, and which Culpepper Starbottle has never been known to deny. My card, sir, you have already. My address, sir, is St. Charles Hotel, where I and my friend, Mr. Dumphy, will be ready to receive you. Look here, said Mr. Dumphy, in surly but sincere alarm, I don't drink because I've been drinking. No offense, Mr. Starbottle. I was only waiting for you to open what you had on your mind in the way of business, to order up a bottle of Clicquot to enable us to better digest it. Take your seat, Colonel. Bring champagne and two glasses. He rose, and under pretense of going to the sideboard, added in a lower tone to the servant who entered, "Stay within call, and in about 10 minutes bring me some important message from the bank, you hear? A glass of wine with you, Colonel. Happy to make your acquaintance. Here we go." The Colonel uttered a slight cough as if to clear away his momentary severity, bowed with gracious dignity, touched the glass of his host, drew out his handkerchief, wiped his mouth, and seated himself once more. "If my object," he began, with a wave of dignified depreciation, "were simply one of ordinary business, I should have sought you, sir, in the busy mart, and not among your lorries and panades, nor in the blazing lights of the festive hall. I should have sought you at that temple which report and common rumor says that you, sir, as one of the favored sons of fortune, have erected to her worship. In my intercourse with the gifted John C. Calhoun I never sought him, sir, in the gladiatorial arena of the Senate, but rather with the social glass in the privacy of his own domicile. Get, sir, in my profession, we recognize some quality in our relations even when professional with gentlemen that keep us from approaching them like a Yankee peddler with goods to sell." "What's your profession?" asked Mr. Dumphy. "Until elected by the citizens of Siskiyou to represent them in the legislative councils, I practiced at the bar. Since then I have been open occasionally to retainers in difficult and delicate cases. In the various intrigues that arise in politics, in the more complicated relations of the two sexes in, I may say, the two great passions of mankind, ambition and love, my services have, I believe, been considered of value. It has been my office, sir, to help the steed of vaulting ambition over the fence, and to dry the tearful yet glowing cheek of beauty. But for the necessity of honor and secrecy in my profession, sir, I could give you the names of some of the most elegant women, and some of the very first men in the land as the clients of Culpepper's Star Bottle." "Very sorry," began Mr. Dumphy, "but if you're expecting to put me among your list of clients, I—" Without taking the least notice of Dumphy's half-returned sneer, Colonel Starbottle interrupted him coolly. "Get, sir, it's out of the question, I'm retained on the other side." The sneer instantly faded from Dumphy's face, and a look of genuine surprise took its place. "What do you mean?" he said curtly. Colonel Starbottle drew his chair beside Dumphy, and leaning familiarly over his desk took Mr. Dumphy's own pen holder and persuasively emphasized the points of his speech upon Mr. Dumphy's arm with the blunt end. "Sir, when I say retained by the other side, it doesn't keep me from doing the honorable thing with the defendant from recognizing a gentleman and trying to settle this matter as between gentlemen." "But what's all this about? Who is your plaintiff?" roared Dumphy, forgetting himself in his rage. "Ged, sir, it's a woman, of course. Don't think I'm accusing you of any political ambition." "Ha? Ha? No, sir. You're like me. It's a woman, lovely woman, I saw it at a glance. Gentlemen like you and me don't go through to 50 years without giving some thought to these dear little creatures. Sir, I despise a man who did. It's the weakness of a great man, sir." Mr. Dumphy pushed his chair back with the grim deliberation of a man who had at last measured the strength of his adversary and was satisfied to risk an encounter. "Look here, Colonel Starbottle, I don't know or care who your plaintiff is. I don't know or care how she may have been deceived or wronged or disappointed or bamboozled, or what is the particular game that's up now. But you're a man of the world, you say, and as a man of the world and a man of sense, you know that no one in my position ever puts himself in any woman's power. I can't afford it. I don't pretend to be better than other men, but I ain't a fool. That's the difference between me and your clients." "Yes, but, my boy, that is the difference. Don't you see? In other cases the woman's a beautiful woman, a charming creature, you know. Ged, sometimes she's as proper and pious as a nun, but then the relations, you see, ain't legal. But hang it all, my boy, this is your wife." Mr. Dumphy, with colorless cheeks, tried to laugh a reckless scornful laugh. "My wife is dead. A mistake, Ged, sir, a most miserable mistake. Understand me. I don't say that she hadn't ought to be. Ged, sir, from the look that little blue-eyed hussy gave you an hour ago, there ain't much use of another woman around, but the fact is that she is living. You thought she was dead, and left her up there in the snow. She goes so far as to say you know how these women talk, Dumphy, Ged, sir, they'll say anything when they get down on a man. She says it ain't your fault if she wasn't dead. Eh? Show. A message, sir, business of the bank, very important, said Dumphy's servant, opening the door. Get out, said Dumphy, with an oath. But, sir, they told me, sir. Get out, will you, roared Dumphy. The door closed on his astonished face. It's all a mistake, said Dumphy, when he had gone. They died of starvation, all of them, while I was away hunting help. I've read the accounts. Colonel Starbottle slowly drew from some vast moral elevation in his breast pocket a well-worn paper. It proved when opened to be a faded, blackened, and bethumbed document in Spanish. Here is the report of the commander of the Presidio who sent out the expedition. You read Spanish? Well. The bodies of all the other women were identified except your wife's. Hang it, my boy. Don't you see why she was accepted? She wasn't there. The colonel darted a fat forefinger at his host and then drew back, and settled his purpled chin and wattled cheeks conclusively in his enormous shirt collar. Mr. Dumphy sank back in his chair at the contact as if the finger of fate had touched him. Chapter 5. MRS. Conroy has an unexpected visitor. The hot weather had not been confined to San Francisco. San Pablo Bay had glittered, and the yellow currents of the San Joaquin and Sacramento glowed sullenly with a dull sluggish lava-like flow. No breeze stirred the wild oats that drooped on the western slope of the Contra Costa Hills, the smoke of burning woods on the eastern hillsides rose silently and steadily, the great wheat fields of the intermediate valleys clothed themselves humbly in dust and ashes. A column of red dust accompanied the Wingdam and One Horse Gulch stagecoach, a pillar of fire by day as well as by night, and made the fainting passengers look longingly toward the snow-patched Sierras beyond. It was hot in California, few had ever seen the like, and those who had were looked upon as enemies of their race. A rashly scientific man of Murphy's camp who had a theory of his own, and upon that had prophesied a continuance of the probable recurrence of the earthquake shock, concluded he had better leave the settlement until the principles of meteorology were better recognized and established. It was hot in One Horse Gulch, in the oven-like gulch, on the burning sands and scorching bars of the river. It was hot even on Conroy's Hill, among the calm shadows of the dark green pines on the deep verandas of the Conroy Cottage Orn. Perhaps this was the reason why Mrs. Gabriel Conroy, early that morning after the departure of her husband for the mill, had evaded the varnished and white-leaded heats of her own house and sought the more fragrant odors of the sedate pines beyond the hilltop. I fear, however, that something was due to a mysterious note which had reached her clandestinely the evening before, and which, seated on the trunk of a prostrate pine, she was now reperusing. I should like to sketch her as she sat there. A broad-brimmed straw hat covered her head, that although squared a little too much at the temples for shapeliness, was still made comely by the good taste with which, aided by a crimping iron, she had treated her fine-spun electrical blonde hair. The heat had brought out a delicate dewy color in her usually pale face, and had heightened the intense nervous brightness of her vivid gray eyes. From the same cause, probably, her lips were slightly parted, so that the rigidity that usually characterized their finely chiseled outlines was lost. She looked healthier, the long flowing skirts which she affected, after the fashion of most petite women, were gathered at a waist scarcely as sylph-like and unsubstantial as that which Gabriel first clasped after the accident in the fateful cannon. She seemed a trifle more languid, more careful of her personal comfort, and spent some time in adjusting herself to the inequalities of her uncouth seat with a certain pouting peevishness of manner that was quite as new to her character as it was certainly feminine and charming. She held the open note in her thin, narrow, white-tipped fingers, and glanced over it again with a slight smile. It read as follows. At 10 o'clock I shall wait for you at the hill near the big pine. You shall give me an interview if you know yourself well. I say beware. I am strong, for I am injured, Victor. Mrs. Conroy folded the note again, still smiling, and placed it carefully in her pocket. Then she sat patient, her hands clasped lightly between her knees, the parasol open at her feet, the very picture of a fond, confiding tryst. Then she suddenly drew her feet under her, sideways, with a quick, nervous motion, and examined the ground carefully with sincere distrust of all artful lurking vermin who lie in wait for helpless womanhood. Then she looked at her watch. It was 5 minutes past the hour. There was no sound in the dim, slumbrous wood, but the far-off sleepy caw of a rook. A squirrel ran impulsively halfway down the bark of the nearest pine, and catching sight of her tilted parasol, suddenly flattened himself against the bark, with outstretched limbs, a picture of abject terror. A bounding hare came upon it suddenly and had a palpitation of the heart that he thought he really never should get over. And then there was a slow crackling in the underbrush as of a masculine tread, and Mrs. Conroy, picking up her terrible parasol, shaded the cold fires of her gray eyes with it and sat calm and expectant. A figure came slowly and listlessly up the hill. When within a dozen yards of her, she saw it was not Victor. But when it approached nearer, she suddenly started to her feet with pallid cheeks and an exclamation upon her lips. It was the Spanish translator of Pacific Street. She would have flown, but on the instant he turned and recognized her with a cry, a start, and a passion equal to her own. For a moment they stood glaring at each other, breathless but silent. "Davridge's," said Mrs. Conroy, in a voice that was scarcely audible. "Good God!" The stranger uttered a bitter laugh. "Yes. Davridge's, the man who ran away with you. Davridge's the traitor. Davridge's the betrayer of your husband. Look at me. You know me, Henry Davridge's. Your husband's brother, your old accomplice, your lover, your dupe." "Hush," she said, imploringly glancing around through the dim woods, "for God's sake, hush." "And who are you?" he went on, without heeding her, "which of the Madame Davridge's is it now? Or have you taken the name of the young sprig of an officer for whom you deserted me and maybe in turn married? Or did he refuse you even that excuse for your perfidy? Or is it the wife and accomplice of this feeble-minded Conroy? What name shall I call you? Tell me quick." "Oh, I have much to say, but I wish to be polite. Madam, tell me to whom I am to speak." Despite the evident reality of his passion and fury, there was something so unreal and grotesque in his appearance, in his antique foppery, in his dyed hair, in his false teeth, in his padded coat, in his thin strapped legs, that this relentless woman cowered before him in very shame, not of her crime but of her accomplice. "Hush," she said, "call me your friend. I am always your friend, Henry. Call me anything, but let me go from here. For God's sake, do you hear? Not so loud. Another time and another place I will listen." And she drew slowly back, until, scarce knowing what he did, she had led him away from the place of rendezvous toward the ruined cabin. Here she felt that she was at least safe from the interruption of Victor. "How came you here? How did you find out what had become of me? Where have you been these long years?" she asked hastily. Within the last few moments she had regained partially the strange power that she had always exerted over all men except Gabriel Conroy. The stranger hesitated, and then answered in a voice that had more of hopelessness than bitterness in its quality. "I came here 6 years ago, a broken, ruined, and disgraced man. I had no ambition but to hide myself from all who had known me, from that brother whose wife I had stolen, and whose home I had broken up from you, Julie. You and your last lover, from the recollection of your double treachery." He had raised his voice here, but was checked by the unflinching eye and cautionary gesture of the woman before him. "When you abandoned me in St. Louis, I had no choice but death or a second exile. I could not return to Switzerland, I could not live in the sickening shadow of my crime and its bitter punishment. I came here. My education, my knowledge of the language stood me in good stead. I might have been a rich man, I might have been an influential one, but I only used my opportunities for the bare necessaries of life and the means to forget my trouble in dissipation. I became a drudge by day, a gambler by night. I was always a gentleman. Men thought me crazy, an enthusiast, but they learned to respect me. Trader as I was in a larger trust, no one doubted my honor or dared to question my integrity. But bah! What is this to you? You! He would have turned from her again in very bitterness, but in the act he caught her eye, and saw in it if not sympathy, at least a certain critical admiration, that again brought him to her feet. For despicable as this woman was, she was pleased at this pride in the man she had betrayed, was gratified at the sentiment that lifted him above his dyed hair and his pitiable foppery, and felt a certain honorable satisfaction in the fact that, even after the lapse of years, he had proved true to her own intuitions of him. I had been growing out of my despair, Julie, he went on, sadly, I was, or believed I was, forgetting my fault, forgetting even you, when there came to me the news of my brother's death by starvation. Listen to me, Julie. One day there came to me for translation a document, revealing the dreadful death of him your husband, my brother do you hear, by starvation. Driven from his home by shame, he had desperately sought to hide himself as I had accepted the hardship of emigration he, a gentleman and a man of letters with the boors and rabble of the plains, had shared their low trials and their vulgar pains, and died among them, unknown and unrecorded. He died as he had lived, said Mrs. Conroy, passionately, a traitor and a hypocrite, he died following the fortunes of his paramour, an uneducated, vulgar rustic, to whom, dying, he willed a fortune this girl Grace Conroy. Thank God, I have the record. Hush! What's that? Whatever it was, a falling bough or the passing of some small animal in the underbrush, it was past now. A dead silence enwrapped the two solitary actors, they might have been the first man and the first woman, so encompassed were they by nature and solitude. No, she went on, hurriedly, in a lower tone, it was the same old story, the story of that girl at Basley, the story of deceit and treachery which brought us first together, which made you, Henry, my friend, which turned our sympathies into a more dangerous passion. You have suffered. Ah, well, so have I. We are equal now. Henry Daveridge's looked speechlessly upon his companion. Her voice trembled, there were tears in her eyes, that had replaced the burning light of womanly indignation. He had come there knowing her to have been doubly treacherous to her husband and himself. She had not denied it. He had come there to tax her with an infamous imposture, but had found himself within the last minute glowing with sympathetic condemnation of his own brother, and ready to accept the yet unoffered and perfectly explicable theory of that imposture. More than that, he began to feel that his own wrongs were slight in comparison with the injuries received by the superior woman. The woman who endeavors to justify herself to her jealous lover, always has a powerful ally in his own self-love, and Daveridge's was quite willing to believe that even if he had lost her love, he had never at least been deceived. And the answer to the morality of this imposture was before him. Here was she married to the surviving brother of the girl she had personated. Had he had Dr. Daveridge's ever exhibited as noble trust, as perfect appreciation of her nature and sufferings? Had they not thrown away the priceless pearl of this woman's love through ignorance and selfishness? You and I, my dear sir, who are not in love with this most reprehensible creature, will be quick to see the imperfect logic of Henry Daveridge's, but when a man constitutes himself accuser, judge, and jury of the woman he loves, he is very apt to believe he is giving a verdict when he is only entering a nulla pros equi. It is probably that Mrs. Conroy had noticed this weakness in her companion, even with her preoccupied fears of the inopportune appearance of Victor, whom she felt she could have accounted for much better in his absence. Victor was an impulsive person, and there are times when this quality, generally adored by a self-restrained sex, is apt to be confounding. Why did you come here to see me? Asked Mrs. Conroy, with a dangerous smile. Only to abuse me. There is another grant in existence for the same land that you claim as Grace Conroy or Mrs. Conroy, returned Daveridge's, with masculine bluntness, a grant given prior to that made to my brother Paul. A suspicion that some imposture has been practiced is entertained by the party holding the grant, and I have been requested to get at the facts. Mrs. Conroy's gray eyes lightened. And how were these suspicions aroused? By an anonymous letter. And you have seen it? Yes, both it and the handwriting in portions of the grant are identical. And you know the hand? I do, it is that of a man now here, an old Californian Victor Ramirez. He fixed his eyes upon her, unabashed she turned her own clear glance on his, and asked, with a dazzling smile. But does not your client know that, whether this grant is a forgery or not, my husband's title is good? Yes, but the sympathies of my client, as you call her, are interested in the orphan girl Grace. Ah, said Mrs. Conroy, with the faintest possible sigh, your client, for whom you have traveled how many miles, is a woman. Half pleased, but half embarrassed, Daveridge said yes. I understand, said Mrs. Conroy slowly. A young woman, perhaps a good, a pretty one. And you have said, I will prove this Mrs. Conroy an impostor, and you are here. Well, I do not blame you. You are a man. It is well perhaps it is so. But, Julie, hear me, interrupted the alarmed Daveridge's. No more, said Mrs. Conroy, rising, and waving her thin white hand, I do not blame you. I could expect I deserve no more. Go back to your client, sir. Tell her that you have seen Julie Daveridge's, the impostor. Tell her to go and press her claim, and that you will assist her. Finish the work that the anonymous letter writer has begun, and earn your absolution for your crime and my folly. Get your reward, you deserve it, but tell her to thank God for having raised up to her better friends than Julie Daveridge's ever possessed in the heyday of her beauty. Go. Farewell. No, let me go. Henry Daveridge's, I am going to my husband. He at least has known how to forgive and protect a friendless and erring woman. Before the astonished man could recover his senses, elusive as a sunbeam she had slipped through his fingers and was gone. For a moment only he followed the flash of her white skirt through the dark aisles of the forest, and then the pillared trees, crowding in upon each other, hid her from view. Perhaps it was well. For a moment later Victor Ramirez, flushed, wild-eyed, disheveled, and panting, stumbled blindly upon the trail, and blundered into Daveridge's presence. The two men eyed each other in silence. A hot day for a walk, said Daveridge's, with an ill-concealed sneer. Vengeance of God, you are right, it is, returned Victor. And you? Oh, I have been fighting flies. Good day. Chapter 6. Gabriel discards his home and wealth. I am sorry to say that Mrs. Conroy's expression as she fled was not entirely consistent with the grieved and heartbroken manner with which she had just closed the interview with Henry Daveridge's. Something of a smile lurked about the corners of her thin lips as she tripped up the steps of her house, and stood panting a little with the exertion in the shadow of the porch. But here she suddenly found herself becoming quite faint, and entering the apparently empty house, passed at once to her boudoir, and threw herself exhaustedly on the lounge with a certain peevish discontent at her physical weakness. No one had seen her enter, the Chinese servants were congregated in the distant wash house. Her housekeeper had taken advantage of her absence to ride to the town. The unusual heat was felt to be an apology for any domestic negligence. She was very thoughtful. The shock she had felt on first meeting Daveridge's was past, she was satisfied she still retained an influence over him sufficient to keep him her ally against Ramirez, whom she felt she now had reason to fear. Hitherto his jealousy had only shown itself in vaporing and bravado, she had been willing to believe him capable of offering her physical violence in his insane fury, and had not feared it, but this deliberately planned treachery made her tremble. She would see Daveridge's again, she would recite the wrongs she had received from the dead brother and husband, and in Henry's weak attempt to still his own conscience with that excuse, she could trust to him to keep Ramirez in check, and withhold the exposure until she and Gabriel could get away. Once out of the country, she could laugh at them both. Once away, she could devote herself to win the love of Gabriel, without which she had begun to feel her life and schemes had been in vain. She would hurry their departure at once. Since the report had spread affecting the value of the mine, Gabriel, believing it true, had vaguely felt it his duty to stand by his doubtful claim and accept its fortunes, and had delayed his preparations. She would make him believe that it was Dumphy's wish that he should go at once, she would make Dumphy write him to that effect. She smiled as she thought of the power she had lately achieved over the fears of this financial magnate. She would do all this, but for her physical weakness. She ground her teeth as she thought of it, that at such a time she should be, and yet a moment later a sudden fancy flashed across her mind, and she closed her eyes that she might take in its delusive sweetness more completely. It might be that it wanted only this to touch his heart. Some men were so strange, and if it were, oh God, she stopped. What was that noise? The house had been very quiet, so still that she had heard a woodpecker tapping on its roof. But now she heard distinctly the slow, heavy tread of a man in one of the upper chambers, which had been used as a lumber room. Mrs. Conroy had none of the nervous apprehension of her sex in regard to probable ghosts or burglars. She had too much of a man's practical preoccupation for that, yet she listened curiously. It came again. There was no mistaking it now. It was the tread of the man with whom her thoughts had been busy, her husband. What was he doing here? In the few months of their married life he had never been home before at this hour. The lumber room contained, among other things, the disjecta membra of his old mining life and experience. He may have wanted something. There was an old bag which she remembered he said contained some of his mother's dresses. Yet it was so odd that he should go there now. Any other time but this. A terrible superstitious dread, a dread that any other time she would have laughed to scorn, began to creep over her. Hark! He was moving. She stopped breathing. The tread recommenced. It passed into the upper hall, and came slowly down the stairs, each step recording itself in her heartbeats. It reached the lower hall and seemed to hesitate, then it came slowly along toward her door, and again hesitated. Another moment of suspense, and she felt she would have screamed. And then the door slowly opened, and Gabriel stood before her. In one swift, intuitive, hopeless look she read her fate. He knew all. And yet his eyes, except that they bore less of the usual perplexity and embarrassment with which they had habitually met hers, though grave and sad, had neither indignation nor anger. He had changed his clothes to a rough miner's blouse and trousers, and carried in one hand a miner's pack, and in the other a pick and shovel. He laid them down slowly and deliberately, and seeing her eyes fixed upon them with a nervous intensity, began apologetically. "They contains, ma'am, Annie, a blanket and a few duds easy I allows used to carry with me. I'll open it if you say so. But you know me, ma'am, well enough to allow that I'd take nothing outer this year house easy I didn't bring inter it." "You are going away," she said, in a voice that was not audible to herself, but seemed to vaguely echo in her mental consciousness. "I be. If ye don't know why, ma'am, I reckon easy you'll hear it from the same vice easy I did. It's Annie the squire thing to say afore I go, easy it ain't my fault nor his n. I was on the hill this mornin' in the old cabin." It seemed as if he had told her this before, so old and self-evident the fact appeared. "I was sayin' I was on the hill, when I heard vices, and lookin' out I seed you with a stranger. From what ye know o' me and my ways, ma'am, it ain't like me to listen to that what ain't allowed for me to hear. And ye might have stood thar until now if I hadn't seed a chap dodgin' round behind the trees, spyin' and listenin'. When I seed that man I knowed him to be a poor Mexican, whose legs I tended yer in the gulch more an a year ago. I went up to him, and when he seed me he'd run. But I laid my hand onto him and he stayed. There was something so unconsciously large and fine in the slight gesture of this giant's hand as he emphasized his speech, that even through her swiftly rising pride Mrs. Conroy was awed and thrilled by it. But the next moment she found herself saying whether aloud or not she could not tell, if he had loved me, he would have killed him then and there. What that man said to me, Bane flustered and savage-like, along o' Bane choked hard to keep him from singing out and breaking in upon you and that entire stranger ain't for me to say. Knowing him longer than I do, I reckon you suspect bout what it was. That it easy the truth, I read it in your face now, ma'am. Easy, I reckon I might HEV read it off and on in many ways and varies styles since we been year together, honey. I was that weak and owned a side year. He raised his hand to his forehead here, and with his broad palm appeared to wipe away the trouble and perplexity that had overshadowed it. He then drew a paper from his breast. I've drawed up a little paper year easy I'll hand over to lawyer Maxwell, make an over back agent all easy I once had owe you and all easy I ever expect to HEV. For I don't agree with that Mexican that what was gin to Grace belongs to me. I allow easy she can settle that herself, if she ever comes, and if I know that chili, ma'am, she ain't goin' tech it with a 2-foot pole. We've allus been simple folks, ma'am, though it ain't the squar thing to take me for a sample and one decayed and common, but thar ain't a Conroy easy lived easy was ever pined for money, or easy ever took more outer the company's wages than his grub and his clothes. It was the first time that he had ever asserted himself in her presence, and even then he did it half apologetically, yet with an unconscious dignity in his manner that became him well. He reached down as he spoke and took up his pick and his bundle, and turned to go. There is nothing then that you are leaving behind you, she asked. He raised his eyes squarely to hers. No, he said, simply, nothing. Oh, if she could have only spoken. Oh, had she but dared to tell him that he had left behind that which he could not take away, that which the mere instincts of his manhood would have stirred him to tenderness and mercy, that which would have appealed to him through its very helplessness and youth. But she dared not. That eloquence which an hour before had been ready enough to sway the feelings of the man to whom she had been faithless and did not love, failed her now. In the grasp of her first and only hopeless passion, this arch hypocrite had lost even the tact of the simplest of her sex. She did not even assume an indifference. She said nothing, when she raised her eyes again he was gone. She was wrong. At the front door he stopped, hesitated a moment, and then returned slowly and diffidently to the room. Her heart beat rapidly, and then was still. Ya ask just now, he said, falteringly, if dar was anything easy I was leavin' behind. Dar is if ye'll overlook my sayin' it. When you and me allowed to leave for furrin parts, I reckon to leave that housekeeper behind, and unbeknow to ye I gin her some money and a charge. I told her that if ever that dear child's sister Grace came here, that she should take her in and do by her easy I would, and let me know. It may be a heap to ask, but if it taint too much I shouldn't like you to turn that innocent insuspectin' chilly away from the house that she might take to be mine. Ye needn't let on anything that's gone, ye needn't tell her what a fool I've been, but just take her in and send for me. Lawyer Maxwell will gin ye my address. The sting recalled her benumbed life. She rose with a harsh dissonant laugh and said, your wishes shall be fulfilled. If she hesitated a moment I am here. But he did not hear the last sentence, and was gone. Chapter 7. What passed under the pine and what remained there? Ramirez was not as happy in his revenge as he had anticipated. He had, in an instant of impulsive rage, fired his mind prematurely, and, as he feared, impotently. Gabriel had not visibly sickened, faded, nor fallen blighted under the exposure of his wife's deceit. It was even doubtful, as far as Ramirez could judge from his quiet reception of the revelation, whether he would even call that wife to account for it. Again, Ramirez was unpleasantly conscious that this exposure had lost some of its dignity and importance by being wrested from his as a confession made under pressure or duress. Worse than all, he had lost the opportunity of previously threatening Mrs. Conroy with the disclosure, and the delicious spectacle of her discomfiture. In point of fact, his revenge had been limited to the cautious cowardice of the anonymous letter writer, who, stabbing in the dark, enjoys neither the contemplation of the agonies of his victim, nor the assertion of his own individual power. To this torturing reflection a terrible suspicion of the Spanish translator, Perkins, was superadded. For Gabriel, Ramirez had only that contempt which every lawless lover has for the lawful husband of his mistress, while for Perkins he had that agonizing doubt which every lawless lover has for every other man but the husband. In making this exposure, had he not precipitated a catastrophe as fatal to himself as to the husband? Might they not both drive this woman into the arms of another man? Ramirez paced the little bedroom of the Grand Conroy Hotel, a prey to that bastard remorse of all natures like his own, the overwhelming consciousness of opportunities for villainy misspent. Come what might, he would see her again, and at once. He would let her know that he suspected her relations with this translator. He would tell her that he had written the letter, that he had forged the grant, that. A tap at the door recalled him to himself. It opened presently to Sal, coy, bashful, and conscious. The evident agitation of this young foreigner had to Sal's matter-of-fact comprehension only one origin, a hopeless, consuming passion for herself. "Dinner has been done gone an hour ago," said that arch virgin, "but I put suthin by for yet. Ye was inquirin' last night about them Conroys. I thought I'd tell ye that Gabriel has been your skin arter lawyer Maxwell, which he's off to Sacramento, although one o' Sue Markle's most intimate friends and steadiest boarders." But Mr. Ramirez had no ear for Gabriel now. "Tell to me, Mees Clark," he said, suddenly turning all his teeth on her, with gasping civility, "where is the Senor Perkins, eh?" "That shiny chap easy looks like a old turned alpaca gowned," said Sal. "That man easy I can't abear," she continued, with a delicately maidenly suggestion that Ramirez need fear no rivalry from that quarter. "I don't mind and don't care to know. He hasn't been here since morning. I reckon he's up somewhere on Conroy's Hill. All I know easy that he sent a message here to get ready his valise to put aboard the Wingdam stage tonight. Are ye going with him?" "No," said Ramirez, curtly. "Axin' your parting for the question, but seein' easy he'd got booked for two places, I thought easy maybe yet got tired o' plain mounting folks and mounting ways, and was goin' with him," and Sal threw an arch yet reproachful glance at Ramirez. "Booked for two seats," gasped Victor, "ah, for a lady perhaps, Mees Clark, for a lady." Sal bridled instantly at what might have seemed a suggestion of impropriety on her part. "A lady like his imprance indeed. I'd like to know who would demean theirs elves by going with the like o' he. But you're not starting out agin without your dinner, and it weighed in yet in the oven?" "No. La. Mr. Ramirez, ye must be in love. I've heard tell easy it do take away the appetite, not knowin' o' my own experience, though it's little hez passed my lips these 2 days, and only when tempted." But before Sal could complete her diagnosis, Mr. Ramirez gasped a few words of hasty excuse, seized his hat and hurried from the room. Leaving Sal a second time to mourn over the effect of her coquettish playfulness upon the sensitive Italian nature, Victor Ramirez, toiling through the heat and fiery dust shaken from the wheels of incoming teams, once more brushed his way up the long ascent of Conroy's Hill, and did not stop until he reached its summit. Here he paused to collect his scattered thoughts, to decide upon some plan of action, to control the pulse of his beating temples, quickened by excitement and the fatigue of the ascent, and to wipe the perspiration from his streaming face. He must see her at once, but how and where? To go boldly to her house would be to meet her in the presence of Gabriel, and that was no longer an object. Besides, if she were with this stranger, it would not probably be there. By haunting this nearest umbrage to the house he would probably intercept them on their way to the gulch, or overhear any other conference. By lingering here he would avoid any interference from Gabriel's cabin on the right, and yet be able to detect the approach of anyone from the road. The spot that he had chosen was, singularly enough, in earlier days, Gabriel's favorite haunt for the indulgence of his noontide contemplation and pipe. A great pine, the largest of its fellows, towered in a little opening to the right, as if it had drawn apart for seclusion, and obeying some mysterious attraction, Victor went toward it and seated himself on an abutting root at its base. Here a singular circumstance occurred, which at first filled him with superstitious fear. The handkerchief with which he had wiped his face, nay, his very shirt front itself, suddenly appeared as if covered with blood. A moment later he saw that the ensanguined hue was only due to the dust through which he had plunged, blending with the perspiration that on the least exertion still started from every pore of his burning skin. The sun was slowly sinking. The long shadow of Reservoir Ridge fell upon Conroy's hill, and seemed to cut down the tall pine that a moment before had risen redly in the sunlight. The sounds of human labor slowly died out of the gulch below, the far-off whistle of teamsters in the Wingdam Road began to fail. One by one the red openings on the wooded hillside opposite went out, as if nature were putting up the shutters for the day. With the gathering twilight, Ramirez became more intensely alert and watchful. Treading stealthily around the lone pine tree, with shining eyes and gleaming teeth, he might have been mistaken for some hesitating animal waiting for that boldness which should come with the coming night. Suddenly he stopped, and leaning forward peered into the increasing shadow. Coming up the trail from the town was a woman. Even at that distance and by that uncertain light, Ramirez recognized the flapping hat and ungainly stride. It was Sal Perdition. Might the devil fly away with her. But she turned to the right with the trail that wound toward Gabriel's hut and the cottage beyond, and Victor breathed, or rather panted, more freely. And then a voice at his very side thrilled him to his smallest fiber, and he turned quickly. It was Mrs. Conroy, white, erect, and truculent. "What are you doing here?" she said, with a sharp, quick utterance. "Hush," said Ramirez, trembling with the passion called up by the figure before him. "Hush. There is one who has just come up the trail. What do I care who hears me now?" "You have made caution unnecessary," she responded, sharply. "All the world knows us now, and so I ask you again, what are you doing here?" He would have approached her nearer, but she drew back, twitching her long white skirt behind her with a single quick feminine motion of her hand, as if to save it from contamination. Victor laughed uneasily. "You have come to keep your appointment, it is not my fault if I am late. I have come here because for the last half hour I have watched you from my veranda, coursing in and out among the trees like a hound as you are. I have come to whip you off my land as I would a hound. But I have first a word or two to say to you as the man you have assumed to be." Standing there with the sunset glow over her erect, graceful figure, in the pink flush of her cheek, in the cold fires of her eyes, in all the thousand nameless magnetisms of her presence, there was so much of her old power over the slave of passion, that the scorn of her words touched him only to inflame him, and he would have groveled at her feet could he have touched the thin three fingers that she warningly waved at him. "You wrong me, Julie, by the God of heaven. I was wild, mad, this morning, you understand, for when I came to you I found you with another. I had reason, Mother of God. I had reason for my madness, reason enough, but I came in peace. Julie, I came in peace." "In peace," returned Mrs. Conroy, scornfully, "your note was a peaceful one, indeed. Ah, but I knew not how else to make you hear me. I had news, you understand, news that might save you, for I came from the woman who holds the grant. Ah! You will listen, will you not? For one moment only, Julie, hear me, and I am gone." Mrs. Conroy, with abstracted gaze, leaned against the tree. "Go on," she said coldly. "Ah, you will listen then," said Victor, joyfully, "and when you have listened you shall understand. Well. First I have the fact that the lawyer for this woman is the man who deserted the Grace Conroy in the mountains, the man who was called Philip Ashley, but whose real name is Poinsett." "Who did you say?" said Mrs. Conroy, suddenly stepping from the tree, and finding a pair of cruel eyes on Ramirez. "Arthur Poinsett, an ex-soldier, an officer." "Ah, you do not believe, I swear to God it is so. What has this to do with me? She said scornfully, resuming her position beside the pine. Go on, or is this all?
No, but it is much.
Look you. He is the affianced of a rich widow in the southern country, you understand? No one knows his past.
Ah, you begin to comprehend.
He does not dare to seek out the real Grace Conroy. He shall not dare to press the claim of his client. Consequently, he does nothing.
Is this all your news?
All, no. There is one more, but I dare not speak it here, he said, glancing craftily around through the slowly darkening wood.
Then it must remain untold, returned Mrs. Conroy, coldly, for this is our last and only interview.
But, Julie, have you done? She continued, in the same tone. Whether her indifference was assumed or not, it was effective. Ramirez glanced again quickly around, and then said, sulkily, come nearer, and I will tell you.
Ah, you doubt?
Be it so. But seeing that she did not move, he drew toward the tree, and whispered, bend here your head, I will whisper it. Mrs. Conroy, evading his outstretched hand, bent her head. He whispered a few words in her ear that were inaudible a foot from the tree.
Did you tell this to him, to Gabriel? She asked, fixing her eyes upon him, yet without change in her frigid demeanor.
No, I swear to you, Julie, no. I would not have told him anything, but I was wild, crazy. And he was a brute, a great bear. He held me fast, here, so. I could not move.
It was a forced confession.
Yes, Mother of God, by force.
Luckily for Victor, the darkness hid the scorn that momentarily flashed in the woman's eyes at this corroboration of her husband's strength and the weakness of the man before her.
And is this all that you have to tell me? She only said.
All, I swear to you, Julie, all.
Then listen, Victor Ramirez, she said, swiftly stepping from the tree into the path before him, and facing him with a white and rigid face. Whatever was your purpose in coming here, it has been successful. You have done all that you intended, and more. The man whose mind you came to poison, the man you wished to turn against me, has gone, has left me never to return, he never loved me. Your exposure of me was to him a godsend, for it gave him an excuse for the insults he has heaped upon me, for the treachery he has always hidden in his bosom. Even in the darkness she could see the self-complacent flash of Victor's teeth, could hear the quick, hurried sound of his breath as he bent his head toward her, and knew that he was eagerly reaching out his hand for hers. He would have caught her gesturing hand and covered it with kisses, but that, divining his intention, without flinching from her position, she whipped both her hands behind her.
Well, you are satisfied. You have had your say and your way. Now I shall have mine.
Do you suppose I came here tonight to congratulate you?
No, I came here to tell you that, insulted, outraged, and spurned as I have been by my husband, Gabriel Conroy, cast off and degraded as I stand here tonight, I love him. Love him as I never loved any man before, love him as I never shall love any man again, love him as I hate you. Love him so that I shall follow him wherever he goes, if I have to drag myself after him on my knees. His hatred is more precious to me than your love.
Do you hear me, Victor Ramirez?
That is what I came here to tell you.
More than that, listen. The secret you have whispered to me just now, whether true or false, I shall take to him. I will help him to find his sister. I will make him love me yet if I sacrifice you, everybody, my own life, to do it.
Do you hear that, Victor Ramirez, you dog? You Spanish mongrel, you half-breed.
Oh, grit your teeth there in the darkness, I know you grit your teeth as you did today when Gabriel held you squirming under his thumb.
It was a fine sight, Victor, worthy of the manly secretary who stole a dying girl's papers, worthy of the valiant soldier who abandoned his garrison to a Yankee peddler and his mule.
Oh, I know you, sir, and have known you from the first day I made you my tool, my dupe.
Go on, sir, go on, draw your knife, do.
I am not afraid,
coward. I shall not scream, I promise you. Come on. With an insane, articulate gasp of rage and shame, he sprang toward her with an uplifted knife. But at the same instant she saw a hand reach from the darkness and fall swiftly upon his shoulder, saw him turn and with an oath struggle furiously in the arms of Davridge's, and without waiting to thank her deliverer, or learn the result of his interference, darted by the struggling pair and fled. Possessed only by a single idea, she ran swiftly to her home. Here she penciled a few hurried lines, and called one of her Chinese servants to her side. Take this, Afe, and give it to Mr. Conroy. You will find him at Lawyer Maxwell's, or if not there he will tell you where he has gone. But you must find him. If he has left town already, you must follow him. Find him within an hour and I'll double that. She placed a gold piece in his hand. Go at once. However limited might have been Afe's knowledge of the English language, there was an eloquence in the woman's manner that needed no translation. He nodded his head intelligently, said, "Me shabby you much e quick," caused the gold piece and the letter to instantly vanish up his sleeve, and started from the house in a brisk trot. Nor did he allow any incidental diversion to interfere with the business in hand. The noise of struggling in the underbrush on Conroy's Hill and a cry for help only extracted from Afe the response, "You muchy go to hell, no fully me," as he trotted unconcernedly by. In half an hour he had reached Lawyer Maxwell's office. But the news was not favorable. Gabriel had left an hour before, they knew not where. Afe hesitated a moment, and then ran quickly down the hill to where a gang of his fellow countrymen were working in a ditch at the roadside. Afe paused, and uttered in a high recitative a series of the most extraordinary ejaculations, utterly unintelligible to the few Americans who chanced to be working near. But the effect was magical. In an instant pick and shovel were laid aside, and before the astonished miners could comprehend it the entire gang of Chin A men had dispersed, and in another instant were scattered over the several trails leading out of One Horse Gulch, except one. That one was luckily taken by Afe. In half an hour he came upon the object of his search, settled on a boulder by the wayside, smoking his evening pipe. His pick, shovel, and pack lay by his side. Afe did not waste time in preliminary speech or introduction. He simply handed the missive to his master, and instantly turned his back upon him and departed. In another half hour every Chinaman was back in the ditch, working silently as if nothing had happened. Gabriel laid aside his pipe and held the letter a moment hesitatingly between his finger and thumb. Then opening it, he at once recognized the small Italian hand with which his wife had kept his accounts and written from his dictation, and something like a faint feeling of regret overcame him as he gazed at it, without taking the meaning of the text. And then, with the hesitation, repetition, and audible utterance of an illiterate person, he slowly read the following. I was wrong. You have left something behind you, a secret that as you value your happiness, you must take with you. If you come to Conroy's Hill within the next 2 hours you shall know it, for I shall not enter that house again, and leave there tonight forever. I do not ask you to come for the sake of your wife, but for the sake of a woman she once personated. You will come because you love Grace, not because you care for Julie. There was but one fact that Gabriel clearly grasped in this letter. That was, that it referred to some news of Grace. That was enough. He put away his pipe, rose, shouldered his pack and pick, and deliberately retraced his steps. When he reached the town, with the shamefacedness of a man who had just taken leave of it forever, he avoided the main thoroughfare, but did this so clumsily and incautiously, after his simple fashion, that two or three of the tunnel men noticed him ascending the hill by an inconvenient and seldom used bypath. He did not stay long, however, for in a short time some said 10, others said 15 minutes he was seen again, descending rapidly and recklessly, and crossing the gulch disappeared in the bushes, at the base of Bald Mountain. With the going down of the sun that night, the temperature fell also, and the fierce, dry, desert heat that had filled the land for the past few days, fled away before a fierce wind which rose with the coldly rising moon, that, during the rest of the night, rode calmly over the twisting tops of writhing pines on Conroy's Hill, over the rattling windows of the town, and over the beaten dust of mountain roads. But even with the night the wind passed too, and the sun arose the next morning upon a hushed and silent landscape. It touched, according to its habit, first the tall top of the giant pine on Conroy's Hill, and then slid softly down its shaft until it reached the ground. And there it found Victor Ramirez, with a knife thrust through his heart, lying dead.